Hi, I'm Nurin, the person behind Deluxe, and I also knitted the Taylor Swift Folklore cardigan. I started this journey in September of 2021, and I finished the cardigan in September 2022, maybe October-ish. It wouldn't have taken me a whole year though if I knew what I was up against. So I thought I'd share with you some of the things I learned while knitting the Folklore cardigan, so hopefully it won't take you as long to knit yours. If you haven't knit yours yet, you can click here to watch all the videos for the tutorial. So before we get started, I thought I'd just give you a quick background on the Folklore cardigan. So it's basically the tie-in cardigan with the Taylor Swift song, Cardigan. That was in her album Folklore, so hence Folklore cardigan. It was released during her Folklore era, and then it sold out really quickly. When Red TV came out, it was restocked again, and then it sold out again. Clearly, the cardigan is in high demand, so I thought, why not make my own? And then, now we kind of have an idea of what the Folklore cardigan is about, I thought I'd share with you a little bit about my knitting background. I started knitting in October 2020, slightly after COVID lockdown ended, because I needed to get material, so that's why it only started when the lockdown ended. And then, this was my third project, I think. My first project was the Harry Styles cardigan, and then my second project was a tank top. So this was the third project that I picked up during my knitting journey. But I mean, since then I have done a lot of knitting projects like in between this one. So I have learned a thing or two after I started working on this one. Anyway, I had never knitted cables before. I have only done intarsia, I did color changing, and then the basic knit, pearl, yarn over. I know all the basic stuff, but I've never done cables before this project. So coming into this, I was completely new to cables. It took me a while to get used to it, and I was having a bit of trouble because there are some parts where you have to hold the cable needle forward, or sometimes you have to hold it backward, and that was a bit confusing for me at first. But as time went on, it gets a lot easier and you kind of get the gist. Like, it's a bit logical when you come to think of it. Like, if you put it at the front, then that's where... You get what I mean if you knitted cables before, I think. Since it took me such a long time to finish this cardigan, I thought I'd give you some tips and also my experience of what I learned from knitting the Taylor Swift Folklore cardigan. So my first tip is to make a gauge swatch. I know in my first video when I did the back ribbing, I was like, I'm just gonna YOLO this because I ain't got time for a gauge swatch. Well, I should have done it. Everybody always talks about making a gauge swatch, and that is a reason for that. It's because your gauge swatch is very important. So if you don't know what a gauge swatch is, gauge swatches are basically small knitted squares that shows you how the yarn is going to work with the needle that you're using. And it will also follow the stitch pattern that you'll be using for the whole of that pattern. So let's say for this one has a lot of cables in it. So your gauge swatch would be cables. And if you're doing stockinette, then it'll be stockinette gauge swatch. Okay, so not only does it show how the yarn is going to work with your needle, but it will also give you the measurements of the swatch, which will then help you determine what will be the final measurement of your cardigan. So that by the end of your knitting process, you will be sure that your cardigan will be able to fit you properly. So the gauge swatch is important for a lot of things, but mostly the fit of the cardigan, how your stitches will look like, and whether the needle size is appropriate, and also it helps with practice. So if you're like me and you have never done cables before, making a gauge swatch will help you practice your cables first before actually starting on the full cardigan. Since I was quite new to cables, making a gauge swatch will help me practice the cables first, and then it'll give me a better understanding of how am I supposed to do it, what are the different charts, and then how to read the instructions, because it can get a little bit confusing between the LC stitches, the LPC, I think it's LPC, LPC stitches and RPC stitches. So I made a lot of mistakes in the beginning, and you could probably tell that from my first few videos, I think the back panel part 1 video and maybe the back panel part 2 video, but I'm not sure. Because halfway through, I frogged everything and then I restarted it. So I think by the back panel part 3 video, everything should be nice already. So it took me a lot of practice, but after a while, I got the hang of it. But then again, working on the cardigan and making mistakes while you're doing your cardigan is a lot more work than just doing it on that small knitted square. So that's why it's important to make a gauge swatch, and you can also double it as a practice time if you've never done cables before. So definitely practice on the smaller gauge swatch first instead of risking it all on the full cardigan. Okay, my next tip is that it's okay to frog your work. So if you don't know what frogging is basically undoing what you've knitted so that it becomes strings again and not just like knitted pieces of fabric. You call it frogging because when you rip it out, it's called like rip it. So rip it, frog. You get where I'm going with this? Yeah, that's where the name comes from. I think a lot of people avoid frogging because of how time-consuming it is. But in my opinion, I think it's worthwhile for that effort because you'll really cherish your piece once you fix it and have a piece that's like... I wouldn't say not full of mistakes, but because we are prone to mistakes all the time, but at least something that's not very noticeable. I think a lot of times I didn't want to frog it because I was like, oh, but I already worked on this for like 6 hours and then now I have to remove everything. But it's better to remove it and make something that you really like rather than have that mistake sitting there and then every time you see it, you won't want to wear it anymore. So the effort of frogging and re-knitting it is worthwhile. Okay, so now that we've established that frogging is horrible, although beneficial, when you frog your work, sometimes you might lose stitches in between, so you might accidentally drop a stitch halfway through. And to prevent this from happening, tip number 3 is to include lifelines in your work. I think I mentioned it in one of the videos, but if you don't know what a lifeline is, it's basically a strand of yarn, or you can use scrap yarn or like yarn from your stash, whatever works, and then you just thread it through your work. So when you drop your work will stop where the lifeline is, so none of your stitches will go missing. This makes it a lot easier for you to put your stitches back onto your needle and you won't have to worry about missing anything. Okay, my next tip is to check your work regularly. Again, we are all prone to mistakes, so if you check your work regularly, you spot the mistake earlier and fix it earlier rather than if you spot it like 20 rows later and then you have to go back 20 rows instead of, oh, you've noticed it 2 rows later, so that's only 2 rows you have to fix back. And lastly is to take your time when knitting. In this age of social media, I think that instant gratification is something that all of us feel at some point in our lives. You see other people posting about their finished work and then you think like, oh, why can't I knit as fast as this other person does? We all want to keep up with the latest trends and have a new outfit for every occasion, but putting this pressure on us is not beneficial in the long run because then we'll always keep producing items and then we'll never stop because there's always a need for more. Knitting will become an activity that stresses you out instead of brings you joy. Well, I hope it brings you joy in the first place and doesn't stress you out. It's not a competition. You can knit at your own time. You don't have to worry about other people. Make something that you will cherish and love for the long haul and not make something because it's just a trend. Literally, look at me. I took like a whole year to finish my cardigan, which I think is incredibly long. So I'm sorry to those who were waiting for me after I posted my back ribbing video because I think I went like MIA for a while because I had school. But not all of it is up, so you can make your own one. Don't rush it. Anyway, if you rush it, you're more prone to mistakes, so yeah, just don't risk it. So it's better to take your time, slow and steady, make sure everything is right, you read the cable charts properly, you're knitting it right, and create something that you will love and wear for a very long time to come. Those are my tips from what I learned from knitting the Taylor Swift folklore cardigan. If you haven't made yours yet, you can check out the videos here and make yours. I have a tutorial for every single part. I go through every single step so you won't get confused. And even if you do get confused, you can still leave me your questions in the comments. And I hope this was helpful, especially if you haven't knitted yours yet and you can get some tips from this video so that you don't make the same mistakes I did. And yeah, if you enjoyed this, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. I'm nurin. I'm the person who delights. This is kind of scary because I don't usually do this. I'm always behind the camera, not in front of it. Well, at least my face is behind it. My hands are in front of it. So yeah, thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one.